In this video, we're going to look into triggers. So what is a trigger? Triggers can be used to stop and start playlists, or act as a specific internal pause point that will allow playback to continue only after the trigger condition is met. You can create a virtually unlimited number of these. For a trigger to be able to fire off a playlist, the S-Play must receive an external command, or an event sent from the S-Play on its internal loopback IP that matches the trigger parameters you've defined. To find out how to create a loopback event, we cover this in the Introduction to Events video. Essentially, the S-Play is constantly evaluating all incoming data to determine if it matches the trigger parameters you've defined. When what you have created is matched, the trigger is actioned. Creating a trigger is as simple as using the Add button next to the search bar, then populating all fields. You can create virtually unlimited quantities of triggers, and the S-Play will organize them into pages, allowing you to search by ID, protocol, or name. When setting up your triggers and control system, we've included a test trigger button on each to speed things up. When this is enabled, the S-Play will wait for your trigger so you can make sure everything works as expected before adding it into your playlists. So onto creating triggers. As you can see, we've added loads of trigger types to the S-Play, making it capable of interfacing with physical buttons and switches through its digital inputs, RS232, Physical DMX, or other network-based protocols. Firstly, we've got OSC. OSC is a control protocol that operates over network. It's often used for audio applications and control systems due to its accuracy and simplicity. This is as simple as giving it a name, selecting OSC in the input type dropdown, then entering the input address. In this example, I'm going to add /go and save the trigger. When the correct OSC string is received, the trigger will be fired off. When sending OSC or UDP to the S-Play, make sure you're using the correct port number as defined on the settings page. Next, we've got RS232. RS232 is received from the S-Play's DB9 port at the rear of the unit. RS232, or serial as it's often called, is a point-to-point protocol, initially conceived in the 60s for low-bandwidth communication. When receiving RS232, there's no need to send line feeds or carriage returns at the end of the string. If the S-Play does receive these, they'll be discarded. To define a trigger, simply add a name, then select RS232 as the input type, and enter the trigger command and press save. Next, we've got digital inputs. These can be found on the rear of the S-Play and can be wired to switches, physical buttons, relays, or sensors using convenient rising clamp pluggable connectors on the rear of the S-Play. These are used to activate a trigger on break or a trigger on make. Break being when the digital input is disconnected from 0V ground, and make being when the connection between the 0V ground and digital input pin is established. For full details of the wiring specs, maximum cable distances and other recommendations, head on over to the user manual. It's important the ground pin is never connected to electrical LAN. If it is, this will short circuit the S-Play's DC input and likely blow the S-Play's internal microfuse. Next, we have UDP. Now once again, this is as simple as defining the name, selecting UDP in the input type dropdown, and then defining a command at the bottom. Finally, we have ARTnet, Streaming ACN, and DMX. You can define the name, the trigger type, and the universal port if physical DMX. If using ARTnet or Streaming ACN, make sure your universes don't overlap. If they do, there's potential that triggers could get fired accidentally if you're broadcasting. We're going to end this video with a couple of quick examples focusing on integrating triggers into playlists. Before diving into the examples, it's worth a look at the three key areas a trigger can be placed on the playlist page. Firstly, we have the start trigger. As you'd expect, when the trigger condition is met, the playlist will start. This also has the option for on power-up. Something I do when commissioning installations is to create a playlist with this enabled. This ensures the installation always ends up in a known state following a power cut. Next, we have the stop trigger. This will do a similar thing, but stop the playlist. It's worth noting that both play and stop take the playlist fade time into consideration, so they won't jump to full intensity instantly if you haven't set them to. It pretty much goes without saying, but if a stop trigger is sent when the playlist is in a stop state, nothing's going to happen. Next, we have the triggers track on the timeline. This allows us to drop triggers precisely into positions on the playlist track. When playing back, once each trigger is reached, it'll pause the playlist until its trigger condition is met. So on with the examples. For the first, I've wired a button to the S-Play's digital input and created a trigger for it. On my playlist page, I've created a playlist that starts on power up. I've added a number of static cues to it, each with an overlapping fade time just after each trigger. When I press the wired button connected to the S-Play's digital input port, you can see the S-Play advances onto the next state. This is a powerful way to get the most out of each digital input, as it means a single button can cycle between a huge number of lighting states. Our second example builds on this idea further, and uses dynamic cues for animated content. For example, you might want to connect the S-Play to an ENTTEC Octo to control multiple universes of pixel tape in a club or bar environment. For this, I've set up three looping playlists. Content was recorded from ENTTEC's ELM pixel mapping software using the S-Play's loop detection feature to make sure each loop is virtually undetectable. You could also create a similar thing using the S-Play's internal effects. Each of these loops is in the same playback group as each other, with the option to restrict to one active playlist per group enabled on the settings page. This allows them to fade smoothly between each other when playing back. I've created a similar playlist as in the previous example, in a different group as my loops, but instead of static scenes, I've added internal OSC events that trigger the playlists above. As I use a physical button to trigger each state, a different content loop is fired, taking the fade time into account. We hope you found this video useful, and if you've got any questions, let us know in the comments or get in touch with the team at enttech.com. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.